let's talk about the Yojana edition for July 2019, and this focuses on e-centric services. Now, over the years, we have been moving towards a digital economy, and we are talking about a digital India. So what are the things that have been the prime focus? The prime focus is direct benefit to transfer scheme, which is the DBT scheme. The idea is to get the money directly into the account of one who is meant for it. So the idea is removing any kind of intermediaries that are there. Again, you have, when it comes to digital education, when it comes to health, all of those platforms are slowly and gradually being merged onto a digital platform. So we'll be talking about some of those one by one. The first and the foremost important one is the banking system. So we have talked about digital banking. We have Aadhaar enabled payment systems, which is the AEPS system that has been introduced. So under that you have BHIM app, UPI payment systems that have been introduced. Similarly, when we talk about agriculture, we have ENAM, that's the electronic national agricultural market. You have GSTN, so that is again on an online platform. All the records, all the certificates can now be kept on a digital platform, which is DigiLocker. You have e-hospital facility, you have Umang platform, where you have all the services that would be available on a common platform. Swayam is one of the good examples for education. You have Jeevan Praman, which is your life certificate for availing pension schemes. So those are some of the major programs that we talk about. For all this, we require active citizen participation, empowerment of the citizen, digital knowledge for the citizens, that is important. And then we are talking about India turning into a $1 trillion digital economy. So that's the potential that we have. Now, to have this potential, definitely we'll have to have more software companies coming in, more software jobs coming in, and Aadhaar enabled system for digital transactions is one of the major initiatives under this line. Now, if we talk about the DBT service, the direct benefit transfer scheme, this has become applicable to LPG connections for public distribution systems, for your Minegra scheme for employment generation. It has also come in as fertilizer subsidy. So those are some of the very basic ones under which we say DBT has been coming up, but it has also come up for your merit means scholarship programs that's there. So any kind of aspect where the amount is going directly to the beneficiary, it's very, very important that you have a service like this. The next is the Stri Swabhiman initiative, which is again an awareness program that has been created by the community service centers. You have Jeevan Praman that we already talked about. Now, other citizen-centric initiatives for Digital India involves India BPO scheme. You have PMGDISHA, which talks about digital literacy in the smaller areas. We have ETAL, which is very, very important. Now, this is electronic transaction aggregation and analysis layer. Now, this portfolio has grown significantly with the electronic transactions increasing over the years. The business process outsourcing are moving to smaller towns. They are moving to towns like Jammu, Srinagar, Aurevilla in Puducherry. You have Madurai, Unnao, Jaipur. So all these smaller centers, which were previously not having so many BPO centers, are now being having numerous BPO centers. We have India, that is the India Enterprise Architecture, which is one of the major initiatives that have come up. Similarly, we are talking about a lot of artificial intelligence under digital system. So all kind of government experiences under India would be having one government experience to the citizen and the business by bringing in best class architectural governance that could be there. We also focus on the National Software Product Mission, which is implementing the policy for software products for 2019. Now, artificial intelligence has come up in traffic, we could say, has come up in agriculture, education, city system, security system. So all those areas we are growing with artificial intelligence. We also have the METI startup hubs that have been established. Now, this is under the Ministry of Electronics and IT. The idea is to promote technology innovation, startups and intellectual properties. Also, we are facilitating TIDE. Now, TIDE is technology incubation and development of entrepreneurs. As we said, India has a $1 trillion digital opportunity that's there. Now, what are the fronts that could be covered? It could be e-governance, it could be healthcare, it could be education, quality of life, energy infrastructure, cyber securities, traffic management, then you have job opportunities, placement section. So all those are the sections where we tend to grow. Now GIS is a geographical information system through which we can focus on environment, natural resource, education, governance. So all those aspects could be covered through the use of GIS, application of GIS. We have the base data, then you have the open source information. You integrate the various layers through the technology and bring in a kind of training for a two-way capacity building. Also, we have systems for mining surveillance, land governance, information systems. We are also talking about the aspirational district management systems. Now, under this surveillance systems, we have surveillance for industry, for mining, for coal, for cybersecurity, social benefit. Now, all these are percolating even to the tribal pockets, even to the remote areas of the countries, the northeast, the far-flung areas, the hilly areas, the mountainous tracts of India. And then we are talking about canal mapping, Delhi police, coal mine surveillance. So those are some of the major issues that have been focused. Now, digital infrastructure, if we talk about across India, we have a huge lot of technological development that has come up in terms of geographical expansion, we could say, in terms of knowledge network that has been established. And then you have numerous data centers that have been established. These data centers mainly have been managed by NIC, that is the National Informatics Centers, sharing the headquarters at Delhi, Hyderabad, Bhubaneswar and Pune. From there, you have a good e-governance surveillance that has been running up. Now, this is in the field of e-hospitals, Jeevan Praman, as we said. Then you have e-passport facility, public distribution systems, transport systems, cyber systems, cyber security, human resource management. We are also talking about a cloud infrastructure, which is Meghraj, that has been initiated in 2014. And through this, you would have the various missions that could be inculcated under one. We have geospatial technology that has been improving the visual gap analysis, on-site representation of various facts, bringing in good governance initiatives. So those have some of the major efforts that have taken place. Since 1980s, we are talking about X400 emails. That is a platform being launched for Government of India, which is an open source secure system for platforming, for message platforming that has taken place. Video conferencing is again an important development that has remarkably grown since 1995. We have numerous computer emergency response team that has an idea to monitor the cyber threat for the computer systems across India. We are also talking about e-way bills for the GSTN. We are talking about enforcement of traffic through e-challan. We are also talking about vehicle dealers, all kind of B2B, C2C transactions, B2C transactions that are being tracked through an electronic portal. Also, we are focusing on development of ICT, that is information and communication technology. So maximum governance with minimum government is the sole idea. Reducing human interference, bringing in automation. So Jam Trinity, Jandan accounts, Aadhaar, and mobile. Along with this, you have a lot of percolation of the bank account going to the rural areas. A lot of digital transactions that have grown through the years. You have PMGDISHA, that is Pradhan Mantri Gramin Digital Skasharta, that is an idea to bridge the digital divide that is taking place. We are also talking about the Umang scheme, as already discussed, which has more than 360 services across 73 departments, which could be availed through the mobile phones. Bringing in development for small and medium scale industries, government e-marketplace, which is also called as the GEM scheme, BHIM and UPI transaction, Aadhaar enabled payment systems, as we have already talked about. Then national policy on software product is very, very important, growing for 2019. We also are talking about a less cash India, where we are talking about paperless, presence-less and a transparent system for transaction. So all kind of hassle-free transaction can take place with a cashless economy. We are bringing in more net banking, debit card, NEFT, RTGS transactions. Cash management infrastructure requires a lot of physical things like printing of the cash, bill collection centers, ATMs to be established. So all of those could be ruled out through a digital channel that could be started. So payment core edits, Investments Jandan program has been some of the key elements of bringing digital initiatives across India. We are also trying to bring in additional authentication for requirements of transactions up to rupees 2000. The idea is to create a kind of safe environment for digital transactions to curb the level of frauds that are taking place and bring in more digital payment and digital awareness among the people. So software-led development, we say in India, we have a mobile data consumption which has been growing nearly 54 times in the last 2 years. With such a high rate of growth, we have nearly 4,000 software companies that are already there, and the national policy on software products focuses on expanding the software products by tenfold in the next 5 to 6 years. So the policy basically talks about a software product development fund, which is providing a kind of market for ready software products, easy software products that are there. We are also talking about the software product taking up to 2 years for the release. So bringing down the periods for the upgrade and the release of the softwares. Also, we are talking about innovation fund models. With the Ministry of Electronics, we have been working closely on this front. The next is talking about open fintech platform. So that is financial and technology combined. So mainly, as we said, under the digital payment system, digital technology has been brought in. So we have the revised payment service directive, which is known as PSD2, that has been enabled. Now, new PSD2 allows third party providers to access the accounts of the consumer, bring in the customer data for approval. So this system would have two categories: PISP and AISP. AISP is the aggregate bank account information and analysis that could be done. PISP is the user account to the merchant account information that would be tracked through a software bridge. So these two forms have been brought in. Again, we have a risk scoring mechanism, which is CIBIL, that has been introduced. The idea is to check out the credit score ranking. We are also talking about the UPI payments, then technology from the customer centric approach. So bringing in kind of open banking, easy banking, business correspondents who could reach to the people and bring in more awareness about the digital transactions is important. Atal Innovation Mission is one of the major ideas for transforming education. We have Swayam platform, MOOC, which are the massive open online courses that have been run. Also, we are talking about creating and monitoring a good mechanism for creating smoother learning experiences. For differentially abled, there have been numerous programs that have come up. So the first is non-visual display access, which is a kind of open source screen reading software that is being availed in the 7 languages in India. We are also talking about text-to-speech conversion. Awaaz is another initiative for augmentative communication. Kabhi is an app for speech impaired child through which quick communication could be done through pictures or pictographic means. BleeWatch notifies the person through the vibrations, colors, or the icons that could be there. So e-service has been very, very important to bring in inclusion of the differentially abled people. Again, you have DAISY Forum of India, which has been working very closely. It's a non-profit organization that has been working for the production and the distribution of reading material, which is accessible to the visually impaired and physically disabled people. When we talk about development as a smart city, these all aspects become very, very important. Digital accessibility and universal design is something that is very, very important. In agriculture, information and communication technology has played a vital role. You have a lot of geospatial technology, a lot of digital network in the form of Ega Market, Fish Market. You have FNET, FedNet. So those are some of the common formats that have been used. Over the years, we believe by 2022, there would be nearly 190 million people who would move away from the agricultural occupation. So there would be a decline in 33% of the workforce. Now 90% of the current jobs in agriculture are skill based, but only 6% of the people actually have the vocational training. So bringing in much more awareness, Krishi Vigyan Kendra, establishing informatic programs for them, bringing in more rural universities, rural courses, farm extension 4.0 to have a smart farmer, smart farming and smart village as a goal is important. Direct benefit to transfer scheme is one of the important important initiative. Also, for the marginalized, we are talking about the digital platforms. So these digital technologies would be bringing in kind of growth and development for the UIDAI, which was established in 2009. Then you have numerous digital benefits, direct benefits that were done through this. The Digital India was launched in 2015, and since then there has been a strong thrust to the Aadhaar program. Recently you have Aadhaar and PAN that could be interchangeably used for your taxing purposes. Similarly, you have new metro line that has to be proposed in Jammu and Srinagar. You have a lot of digital rationing that have been given a thrust, digital Skasharta Abhiyan that has been focused on. We are also talking about Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, but through a digital infrastructure, tracking the progress of the houses that have been built. Similarly, Antodaya scheme, the Deen Dayal Upadhyay schemes, all those schemes where the implementation has to take place, digital drive has been important, understanding the progress that has taken place over the years. For the metro rail, we have the urban transport policy that has come up in 2006. The recent development, we have already taken a separate lecture, so you can just go back and refer that. The first metro came up in Kolkata. Since then, you have numerous cities where you have metro projects that have been coming up. It's a capital intensive project. It requires a lot of years under development, and therefore it's a kind of value capture financing system that's required. Standardization of the metro components that are very, very important for the same. Transit-oriented development is important. So you have three levels of transit-oriented development, which is the station level, area level and city level that is required. Also, there is an idea of national common mobility card which has been proposed that could be universally used across all metros in India, be it in Delhi, be it in Kochi, any new metro coming up. You are also talking about the Unified Metropolitan Transport Authority. So that should be set up to integrate and coordinate the urban transport systems. The National Transport Mission, the policy 2006, monitors the various aspects of public transport. The toolkit for citywide multimodal integrated transport plan, traffic management systems, bringing in rapid rail transport systems as in Gurgaon. So that's where the future of metro is going. When it comes to health, we are talking about digital health. So e-hospital is one of the such initiatives. Then we talk about the coverage, inclusiveness, privacy, building in much more authenticity for the people to avail the digital facilities through the hospitals. So national digital health blueprint applications have been laid down, where we are talking about the applications for the healthcare systems, understanding the outcomes that could be generated through it. So we have the three artifacts that we are talking about: the physical asset, the digital asset and the artifact, and the short term and the medium term goals for each of those to be achieved. Besides this, we are also talking about the national health portal, online registration system through the major hospitals across India. Food Safety and Standards Authority of India has been working closely with it. And then you also have the National Organ and Tissue Transplant Organization, which has gone digital. We are also focusing on the RBI's vision document, which is talking about the positive outcomes from 2015 to 2018 in terms of digital payments that have been done. We are focusing on a payment system vision 2021, which is focusing on financial inclusion, protection of the customer and checking out the competition that exists, bringing in new players into the system and giving a thrust to a digital payment and a digital economy as such. So those were some of the major highlights, which is much more customer centric, e-centric and focusing on digital payments, digital education and digital health. So those were some of the key focuses for today's class. We'll be bringing in many more lectures for you. Have a wonderful day ahead. Stay tuned.